This video is brought to you by my supporters over on Patreon. Thanks to all of my patrons who make all of the videos on this channel possible. If you like my work and would like to support the creation of new music, as well as free educational resources, head over to Patreon. You'll get perks like early access, exclusive content, and director's commentary, as well as input on what videos are made. So come join the community on Patreon today. See, if I just played this, you already know what's coming. Tell me your foot's not tapping. If you're not familiar, this is Linus and Lucy from the Vince Guaraldi Trio from the Charlie Brown Christmas special, which may explain why it's played at Christmas, or at least why it's on my Christmas playlist. It's infectious, it's an earworm, it's been stuck in my head for over a week, but that's mostly just because I've been analyzing it for this video. So why does this piece work so well? Well, it's an effective use of repeated material. It's a delicate balance in music. You want there to be a nice blend of new material and repeated material. We as humans enjoy both of these things. We like the novelty of new experiences, but we also like the familiarity of repeated experiences. Same in music. We want there to be a blend of repetition and novelty. Our ears like the ability to hear something new, but then also the ability to soak it in. These two must remain balanced. Too much novelty, and it can become jarring or even forgettable. Too much repetition, and it can become monochromatic. And of course we know, familiarity breeds contempt, or perhaps boredom. Most songs and pieces are an exploration of one or two main ideas. A nice blend of the novel and the repeated. Of course, never repeating and over-repeating can both be used to great effect, but that's for another time. The first thing we hear is a repeated bass line. This bass line will become the foundation on which the opening section is built. We hear that a lot in music. We can call these repeated phrases either loops or ostinatos. We can also see that the rhythm of this bass line will stay constant throughout the section, while the pitches change to fit the harmony. On top of this ostinato comes the main theme for the song, which immediately causes dancing. I mean, tell me you don't want to dance like that. We can also repeat patterns within the melody. New ideas are reinforced by repetition. If we break down this melody, there are essentially two ideas. I'll call these figures 1 and 2. Crazy thing is, the melody here is only 3 notes, and this over here is just figure 2 backwards, which is sometimes called a retrograde. The first phrase plays figures 1 and 2, while the second phrase only uses figure 1. That exact melody is played again to complete the idea, so for that I'll use a small A. The second part of this section, which we'll call small B, is also made up of two basic ideas. We'll call them figures 3 and 4. Each figure repeats 3 times. The A theme will return after this, but it's simple enough, catchy enough, and repeated enough that by now the audience could probably sing along. The A theme repeat gives us an ABA form, or a ternary form, for the opening section. This is a bit of a form within a form, which we call an internal form. Another delicate balance in music is similarity in contrast. We generally want music to sound cohesive, like all of the material belongs together. But again, we don't want to become monochromatic, or one-colored. Contrast is a really good way to do this. There are a lot of different ways that we can create contrast. Fast versus slow, loud versus soft, we can change up the instrumentation. There are two other sections in this piece, and in contrast to the opening melody, there's not as much repetition within the melody. This is a good way to keep what does repeat from going dull. The second section sounds like this. Even though there are less repeats, the section is still built on two contrasting ideas. The block chords, which are based on repeated chords, and then the melodic arpeggiation, which is not as repetitive. The third section is by far the biggest contrast. It changes to a compound meter compared to the simple meter we've been in for the first two sections. It features a walking bass line, and the melody as a whole is more improvisatory. Another way that we can repeat is to use the structure of the music. We can repeat entire sections. Another important concept in composition is the idea of the hook. In a classical context, this might be known as a motif or a theme or perhaps a subject if we're talking about fugues, which we're not. The point with all of these is to be somewhat of a thesis statement for our ears. And this is a very strong hook. You want your hook front and center multiple times throughout. For Linus and Lucy, that structure looks like this. We have an A section in two parts, followed by a B section, and then a repeat of the A section, but it's only the first melody. Then a C section, followed by another repetition of the A section, followed by a little bit of an outro to close it out. That's something that we see in For Elise from Schroeder's favorite composer.
What kind of Christmas music is that?
Beethoven Christmas music.
We often think of this piece as just the A section. It's another good hook. If we look at the structure for this one, it looks familiar, if not exactly the same. In Western classical music, this is known as rondo form. Generally speaking, in rondo form, the A theme is known as the refrain, where each of the following themes are known as episodes. As we saw in both pieces, the refrain is in contrast to each episode. In the classical period, it was convention for each of the episodes to take place in a related key to the refrain. There's really no limit to the number of episodes that a rondo form can have, but most will stick to A, B, A, C, A. This form may seem very familiar to all of us. Most modern songs have a structure that alternates between verses and choruses with a bridge somewhere in the middle. Since we've been calling the hook the A theme, that would give most modern songs this kind of structure. Meaning that a song that started with its chorus would have this structure. It's effectively the same form that we've been looking at with some repeated verses. But it's important to remember that this form is not rigid. It's not rules to be followed. This is just a codification of common patterns. And before we get too far into it, modern song requires its own video for in-depth discussion, so we'll leave it at that. So how does Linus and Lucy effectively use repeats, and how can we apply that to our own writing? Well, I see six ways that we've talked about in this video. One, we can use it in the ostinato. Two, we can repeat notes in the melody. Three, we can repeat in the melodic structure. Four, we can repeat entire sections, especially the hook. Five, we can blend the repetition with the novel. And six, we can cleanse the palate with contrast. And we do all of these things in moderation, which just leaves a couple of questions. Is Linus and Lucy a Christmas song? And two, when is it too early to listen to Christmas music?